Everyone, thanks for coming out. My name is Kyle Cleveland. I'm with Temple University's Institute of Communication Studies. This event tonight, Japan's International Relations and Politics of 3-1, has been in the works for some months now. And of course, I see many of you represent embassies and various organizations here. And I think every organization has gone through, you know, in maybe a smaller scale, the kinds of things that various state actors and embassies went through here in Japan. This evening, we have Japanese government represented by Noriyuki Shikata, who's the Deputy Cabinet Secretary for Public Affairs, the Director of Global Communications in the Prime Minister's Office. We have Sir David Warren, who's the British Ambassador to Japan. And first up, we have Mark Davidson, who's the Minister of Council for Public Affairs in the U.S. Embassy. Mark Davidson has served in the U.S. Embassy as a Minister of Council since March of 2012. He's a career senior service officer. The U.S. government's largest rate of media information, cultural, and educational programs in the East Asia Pacific region. He spent more than half of his career working on or in East Asia. His previous diplomatic career in Japan included as a cultural affairs officer in Tokyo, public affairs officer of the Consulate General of Sapporo, and deputy director of the Tokyo American Center. In Washington, he has been a senior advisor in the Bureau of East Asian and Pacific Affairs, Public Diplomacy Desk Office of Japan and Korea, and Special Advisor for Asian Affairs to the House of Representatives International Relations Committee, with many other positions as well. And most recently, he's just come back to Japan after being in Pakistan with the Better Part, which I'm sure we'd all be interested to hear as well. The way this will work this evening is each of our distinguished guests will make short remarks and talk about their own government's response. And if you could hold your questions until the very end, then we'll ask questions to them directly. So if we could please welcome Mark Davis.
Thank you, Kyle. It's truly an honor to be here with you this evening, with my distinguished co-panelists and this wonderful group of people here at Temple. As Kyle mentioned, this is my fourth time in Japan as a diplomat. My fifth time if you include staying here during my graduate school year. So I guess the personnel philosophy of the Department of State is we're going to keep sending it back until I get it right. We're going to try and get it right with you this evening. My presentation will, I think, set the basis for what I hope will be a very rigorous question-answer session after we finish the formal part of the meeting. I did not ask to go first. I did not presume that I would go first. However, I was requested to go first because my presentation lays out perhaps some of the historical background to the terrible events of March 11, 2011, and hope set the stage for the rest of the evening's discussion. I was in Islamabad, Pakistan. It was lunchtime. I went into the embassy cafeteria, and people were around the television set. Normally, at lunchtime, they were watching Pakistani soap operas or a cricket match. But I couldn't figure out what was going on. But very soon, someone came to me and said, "Mark, you've been to Japan before, haven't you? You should take one of those." I don't think any of us, wherever we were on that day, forget what we felt. If we felt the earthquake itself, or whether it was the shock we received when we heard about the terrible news from at least I, at that moment, when I first started to integrate what we were seeing on TV screens, decided that I would make every effort possible to come back to Japan and contribute whatever way I could. And moving on and recovering from this terrible tragedy. You all know these images? And of course, these terrible images that went around the world and to some extent helped to create the narrative that riveted the world's attention for so long after 3/11. But what we'd like to talk about tonight is not the event itself, but the response. The photograph you see here was taken in the parking lot in front of the U.S. Embassy in Akasaka, immediately after the entire embassy community, something around 500 people who worked in that 10-story building there. As soon as the embassy staff evacuated, and Ambassador Bruce came out with a bullhorn to tell people that we were experiencing perhaps an unprecedented disaster, and to stay calm and to wait instructions. Within a single hour after the earthquake struck, the ambassador formally declared an emergency, which set into action a whole series of bureaucratic responses. It also immediately triggered dispatch of what we call a disaster assistance response team, or DART, which included search and rescue teams from Fairfax, Virginia, and Los Angeles County, as well as nuclear experts and Nuclear Regulatory Commission. So I think it's fair to say that the first response of Ambassador Bruce was to take action. Determined that we needed, what had happened was far beyond our capabilities as an embassy to respond to, and we needed assistance. Informing Washington of this declaration set into action, as I mentioned, a whole series of responses on the part of the United States government. Meanwhile, our military also sprung into action just as quickly. Eventually, within hours, it was named Operation Tomodachi. Tomodachi, of course, Japanese word, beautiful Japanese word for friend or friendship. The immediate focus of Operation Tomodachi was the rescue of as many lives as we could possibly save. In the end, including search and rescue airborne missions, delivering food, clothing, and bottled water, the operation eventually involved as many as 24 different U.S. Navy ships, 189 aircraft, and a total of 24,000 U.S. military personnel working side by side, absolutely interoperably with their Japanese Self-Defense Force colleagues. And I think this is a fundamental point I'd like to make. This was not a unilateral American response. It was a joint mission from the outset. Americans and Japanese working together to try to help as much as possible the people who were in the Great Fire. Within a week after 3/11, our mission in Tokyo was only transformed. It grew to more than twice its normal size. As many as 150 additional personnel flew in from all over Asia, from Washington, in fact, from all around the world. Many of my colleagues in the Foreign Service who previously served in Japan had a level of familiarity with the language and the culture and geography of this great country, raised their hands immediately. We brought them in from Latin America, from Pakistan, from Central Europe, wherever they happen to be at the moment, just as the American people responded with perhaps an unprecedented level of concern and generosity to the people of Japan. So did, too, my colleagues in the Foreign Service respond with an outpouring of volunteer energy and activity to come and try to do something positive to help. But in addition to diplomats, we also brought in experts from throughout the U.S. government in the areas of nuclear, radiation, and health to both advise and work with our Japanese government counterparts and friends, and also advise the ambassador and Washington from their on-the-scene view of what was going on. At the same time, the embassy stood up 24/7 response centers in the State Department headquarters in Washington as well, too. We set up special teams 24/7 to monitor the situation, to maintain communications among the various branches of the U.S. government, civilian and military, and equally as important, to try to account for the whereabouts of the somewhere near 160,000 Americans who were in Japan at the time. The fact is that we all know that the initial days were fraught with confusion, missteps, and miscommunications. But I would dare anyone here in this room to name a government or a country anywhere on earth who could have dealt with a disaster of this incredible magnitude any better. within a short amount of time, I believe that it's fair to say the U.S. government has established extraordinarily close communication and cooperative relationships with our Japanese government counterparts at all levels, from the working level to the summit level of our two governments. And we immediately began a very effective coordinated series of activities. Our nuclear response team met every night with a very impressive young Japanese leader, Goshiko Sono, who was the prime minister, had been appointed to manage the joint response efforts, along with representatives from TEPCO, the utility, of course, that ran the Fukushima plants, and the relevant Japanese ministries and agencies. My office in the embassy established very, very good relationships with Mr. Shikata here and his team as we exchanged information and discussed how we could most effectively communicate not just to people in Japan, the United States, but the people of the world about the unfolding and ever-changing situation. Working together, we were able to coordinate to an extraordinarily high degree our nuclear assistance to Japan. It came in the form of not only technical expertise, but those of us, I think, all of us here, I think, remember the images from the television screens, fire trucks, industrial pumping systems, fresh water barges, disseminators to measure radiation exposure, robots, water tanks, and anything else that either the Japanese or we thought was needed or could possibly be of assistance in containing a situation the likes of which no nation had ever seen before. And at the same time, U.S. Departments of Energy and Defense working together began a sophisticated support operation to monitor and measure the air, ground, and water radiation from the Fukushima plants that included more than 100 flights and 282,000 measurements for those who are taking those, 282,000 measurements on the ground. And very briefly, I promise you briefly, let's go through some of the detailed responses that various parts of the U.S. government engaged in. First of all, as I mentioned, the embassy set up immediate response units. The lower left is our political 24/7 crisis management team that kept communications between our governments, among the various branches of our governments, going all day and all night. On the upper right is an image of what looks to be the same, but another team that had a very different mission, which was our consular assistance team, to ensure that we could account for all Americans in Japan, responding to a barrage of telephone calls, emails, letters sent by carrier pigeon, thousands and thousands of Americans concerned about their family members, their relatives, or their friends in Japan, contacted the Department of State if they were unable to get through to them. Many Americans in Japan contacted us, unable to get through to their loved ones overseas, and we tried to make sure that everyone could eventually reunite, first perhaps virtually by email or social media, and eventually, of course, in person. I think many of us may know that we lost two Americans on that day, both of whom were young teachers who had dedicated their time and the last part of their lives to engaging with young Japanese people and building bridges of friendship between our two countries. But it's quite remarkable given the extent of the damage that only two Americans, in fact, passed away that day. And again, these are scenes from some of our consular officials who immediately were deployed to the disaster area to even go door to door, looking where we knew or we thought that Americans had been living, tried to account for everyone. And they shared the same conditions that the people of the region were going through, sleeping in the rough in very cold evenings, finding a corner in an evacuation center, dedicated 20 hours a day, catching a few nods here and there where they could to trying to account for American citizens who were missing. These are images from Operation Tomodachi, the military rescue and relief operation that was immediately set into action. One of the many wonderful things about the United States military is they come with logos for everything. And you'll see the patch here that all of the 24,000 U.S. active duty personnel who were involved in that operation very proudly sported on their uniforms. And those of us in the embassy today many of us still have those in our offices as badges of pride that we were participating in something very important. The first logistical challenge for Operation Tomodachi was Sendai Airport. I think many of us will remember the images of the waves rolling across the tarmac there. That airport was located so close to the sea. It was clear for the from the perspective of military planners that Sendai Airport would be the crucial node in getting supplies in to the people who needed them in the Tohoku region. So this was the first kind of military objective, as it were. And this really stands as one among many tremendous examples of absolute seamless cooperation between the U.S. military and their Japanese self-defense counterparts in ensuring that this airport was opened as quickly as possible, even though many people around the world, seeing these images, would not have believed it possible. Once the airport, in fact, was opened to traffic, for a brief while, U.S. military air traffic controllers guided flights into safe landing. And in 21 days, a total of 250 relief aircraft managed to use that airport and deliver over a million kilograms of humanitarian aid and 56,000 liters of diesel fuel and gasoline. On April 1st, complete control of the airport was transferred back to our Japanese friends, and they maintained a very high pace of operations. Sendai Airport proved to be really an invaluable lifeline, a link to the people of Tohoku to get them what they needed. The U.S. Agency of International Development, AID, I think we would not often believe that AID would be active in a developed country like Japan. AID, however, has a wide variety of roles, one of which is to respond as the lead U.S. government agency in the case of a natural disaster anywhere on Earth. OFDA, the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, has tremendous experience in a variety of environments in coordinating all of government response on the part of our nation. As I mentioned earlier, search and rescue teams from Los Angeles and Fairfax, Virginia, just outside of Washington, D.C., were flown to Japan within hours of the disaster and participated side by side with Japanese in the aftermath, looking to assist people. And when that was no longer possible, obviously working to help bring home the remains of those who were perished on that day. As I mentioned earlier, of course, perhaps what the dominant narrative after a couple of days for many who were following this disaster in the media outside of Japan, of course, was the nuclear situation that was developing in the Fukushima plants. The U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, NRC, has the lead in the U.S. government in dealing with such crises, both in the United States and, of course, overseas. And we brought in a number of experts to the embassy, as I mentioned, to advise the ambassador directly and to communicate back home to Washington to make sure that we had timely and accurate information that allowed us to make the proper determinations and decisions in the U.S. government and also allowed us to communicate accurately and quickly what we knew to people in Japan, in the United States, and elsewhere. U.S. Department of Energy also played a very important role in providing a robot to help assess what was actually going on during those early and quite frightening days in the plants. As important as anything else, I think that my friend Shikata-san will perhaps talk about this in a little detail, of course, was communications. The whole world is watching. And I was about as far from Japan as you could possibly get culturally. And politically in Pakistan, and I can tell you that every single newspaper in Pakistan, every single television news broadcast led day in and day out with the situation in Japan. The ambassador understood, as all U.S. ambassadors do in times of crisis, that every single word that he uttered would be examined, would be analyzed, would be debated. Why did he choose very instead of much? What exactly does he mean? But that could not stop us from communicating. Very quickly, we decided that our strategic messages were simple, as good, effective strategic messages must be. Don't panic. The best minds in the world are working on this. Japan is going through a great crisis and needs the assistance of people around the world. But Japan is and will be open for business, and Japan will rebuild with the help of its friends and neighbors from around the world. every utterance of the ambassador, whether on television, in an interview to a journalist, or in his increasingly popular Twitter messages, was measured against this standard. Are we getting out accurate information? Are we helping to move things to a satisfactory conclusion, a satisfactory resolution for the people of Japan and in the United States and around the world? We all know there's a tremendous amount of confusion in the media, a lot of different stories that were out there. And what is really an interesting story that remains to be analyzed in a number of academic conferences and papers going forward is the incredibly interesting role that social media played. First in linking people together who wanted to know what happened to you, where are you, who wanted to tell, I'm safe, I'm okay, this is where I am, we need help here, we're running out of water, there's someone sick, there's someone injured. But also, the ways in which social media allowed people to seek out the truth. If they were dissatisfied with what the traditional media were providing, this perhaps was an interesting moment of discovery for Japanese of all ages, that there were ways in which people could engage themselves, not simply be passive recipients of information coming unidirectionally from above, but these lateral connections were extraordinarily important. As a result of this, in fact, Ambassador Roos became, and remains today, the most followed U.S. ambassador anywhere on Earth outside of the United States. We're proud of that. 54,000 and counting. So those of you who are not getting his feed at Ambassador Roos, go home tonight, you know, get on Twitter and subscribe, because he's got a lot of interesting things still to say. And for a long time, he was among the top 0.001% of people around the world whose messages were retweeted. It wasn't just about, you know, the initial network, it was about the whole network. People said, this is really interesting, I'm going to send this on to my friends. I'm going to post this. So this social media, I think perhaps future historians will look back and look at two points in Japan, in the evolution of social media in Japan. The first, of course, was the power of Hollywood, the movie The Social Network. And perhaps the second turning point was 3/11. And the ways in which people determined that they could find information for themselves and link with other people at a time when these linkages were absolutely vital. Then we can talk more about the communication strategy and how we work together with our Japanese friends if you'd like to do the Q&A. Let's move forward. Operation Tomodachi was the initial response by the U.S. military. Great name, great brand. They did great things. Moving forward, however, past the immediate relief stage and moving into recovery, under the leadership of Ambassador Roos, we decided that we needed to look forward. That as a nation, as an embassy, we wanted to help Japan not just get over this terrible crisis, but build for the future. And so we devised something which we call the Tomodachi Initiative, which is a series of coordinated investments in young people in Japan, primarily but not exclusively in Tohoku, and in the United States, to build the next generation of leaders on both sides of the Pacific who are linked, not merely by mutual understanding of each other's cultures, customs, politics, societies, and history, but are linked as well by affection, who have an emotional stake in the future of the bilateral relationship. We thought this was perhaps the most effective way in which we could memorialize those whose lives were lost, were forever changed by 3/11. And it was the best way that we could build forward in a win-win way for both of our societies. Because Ambassador Roos is a very good communicator, and he's a very forceful personality, and you might have heard his very high links in the White House, he was able to cut through a lot of bureaucratic obstacles to create the Tomodachi Initiative an extraordinarily short period of time, and to build something that hasn't been done before, a major public-private partnership where the U.S. Embassy is basically out fundraising. We have a number of very, very generous, unfortunately deep-pocketed donors in the corporate sector in Japan and the United States to provide funds that we then provide to young people to allow opportunities for Americans and Japanese to study together, to work together, to learn together, and to build these ties of understanding and affection that we believe will make our relationship even stronger going on into the 21st century. You may have seen that as recently as Sunday, we've had a whole parade of celebrities that have been inspired by the Tomodachi vision. Everyone from Lady Gaga, we all know the Gaga teacup, right? $76,000, I believe it was, to fund an arts scholarship to bring young Japanese studying arts in the United States. Tom Cruise, Will.i.am, we do a lot of sports activities as well too. Paul Ripken, the Iron Man of the United States. And most recently, just this past Sunday, on the bottom left of the screen, Hillary Clinton came and met with 21 members of the Tomodachi Generation, we're calling them, Japanese and Americans, who are committed to learning more about each other, studying each other's countries, and we believe are going to be at the base of the leadership of both of our nations, who will lead us both into an ever closer relationship in the future. A terrible, terrible event, really. It is hard to say that there were silver linings to it at all. I think many of us may recall that at the end of 2011, a collection of great Japanese experts declared the word of the year to be kizuna, or links, linkage, human connection. We hope that the Tomodachi Initiative will allow us to build these kizuna even stronger and move forward in a way that makes both of our nations better countries going on to the future. Our commitment to Japan is, as it always has been, unwavering. And again, whether it be at the summit level, we see the Prime Minister and President in Washington a few weeks ago, or I would say even more importantly at the people level. For instance, one initiative we are taking is that we, in observance of the centennial of Japan's donation of 3,000 flowering cherry trees to people in the United States, and the way that we're still standing around the tidal basin in downtown Washington, D.C., we are donating for the next couple of years 3,000 dogwood trees, American dogwood, if you're careful not to choose Asian dogwood, American dogwoods to the people of Japan. And because we have to wait for the dormancy season to plant, we're not going to start planting until this coming fall, but very soon, would predict you'll see high-ranking Americans and Japanese planting dogwoods as, we hope, an eternally flowering symbol of our relations, not just looking backwards, but looking forward as well. And two final images. The upper left is Ambassador Roos, his first of 12 trips to the disaster-affected region, interacting with young members of what we like to think is the Tomodachi Generation, and then a nice expression of appreciation on the part of some beautiful young Japanese children. So thank you very much. I look forward to the formal interesting part, which will be the presentation of my colleagues here, and then our question and answers. Thank you.
Our next panelist is Noriyuki Shikata. Nori is the Deputy Cabinet Secretary for Public Affairs and the Director of Global Communications in the Prime Minister's Office of Japan. During the last 8 years, Shikata-san has worked as Director of Status of U.S. Forces Agreement Division, the Assistant Press Secretary, Director of the International Press Division, as well as the Director of Second North American Division, dealing with economic relations with the U.S. and Canada. He's been the Director of Economic Treaties Division, the International Legal Affairs Bureau, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. After entering MOFA back in 1986, he was press officer at the Embassy of Japan in Washington and worked in the U.S.-Japan Economic Relations from 1995 to 1997. He was also first secretary of the delegation of the OECD in Paris, dealing with energy issues. He's also associated with Chile University as a lecturer, and he's the 2011 recipient of the Gold Standard Award for Political Communications, the award hosted by the Public Affairs Asia in recognition for his work in this last year.
Thank you, Kyle, for the kind introduction. Actually, it's my second time to come to DUJ in my current capacity. And last time I came to DUJ was in February 2011. And I spoke under the theme of the Khan administration's diplomacy in the Asia-Pacific region. And I discussed issues like TPP, emerging policy issues, and third opening of Japan, Daisan no Kaikoku, and those kind of issues. So after, I guess it was less than 1 month that I came here, that 3/11 took place. So it's kind of surprising how quickly changing the world and the situations surrounding our countries. Today I'm really honored, you know, to be able to speak with my great friends, both countries, both the United States and UK, who played such an important role, pivotal roles, for Japan to recover from the challenges after 2011. And in a sense, both countries played tremendous roles, but they were playing somewhat different roles. And this is something I guess, you know, we will be discussing later. But these are the issues that you know, we benefited so much from the support from the United States and the UK government and the private sector people in the process of coping with various challenges after 2011. My office of global communications was established 2 years ago, and I was kind of recruited to the Prime Minister's office. There was a political initiative to create a unit focusing on global communications. It was initiative by the current Minister of National Policy Unit, Minister Furukawa. And having, I guess he's been attending Davos meetings and other international meetings. And he was very much concerned about relative decline of Japanese presence overseas in international meetings. And he made the case that having Office of Global Communications in Prime Minister's office is very important. So we started out with four officials and later joined by some private sector people. There's Yoshimitsu Kaji, who is over there, who used to, in his prior capacity, he was a global marketing chief of Nissan Leaf. He was working on communications issues in the private sector. And before 3/11, what we were trying to do was to come up with some global communication strategies for Japan, how we could leverage some of our comparative advantage of our own country. And I will discuss those issues at the end of my presentation. As you already know, this 3/11 was a very complex and compounded damages being created, generated. Primary damage, earthquake, tsunami, and with the nuclear power plant accidents, you know, the immediate, you know, power shortages, and obviously concerns regarding radiation. And as I followed, or as I responded to all the international media requests for interviews, I said that 70-80% of the interview requests that I received or I conducted the interview with during the last, a little over 1 year, over maybe 200 of them, but radiation-related issues, nuclear power plants-related issues, or food safety concerns. Of course, this led to what we call reputational damages, kūkyō higai, in terms of the kind of tourism or imposition of food restrictions on food exports from Japan. So the kind of challenges that we were facing as a government was very complex, even if you are focusing on communications issues. In my capacity as a Deputy Cabinet Secretary for Public Affairs, I played the role of international press spokesperson. And I'm the only one who responds to media interviews. If CNN or BBC wants to conduct interviews, I'm pretty much the only one who do interview in English, live. And the day two, on the 13th of March, well, actually, the next day, there were gradually, you know, like interview requests coming, and I consulted with my boss, what shall we do? And of course, the Prime Minister's office at that time was in a very, very much of a crisis management mode. And not many people are focusing on handling, you know, international media. So I said that, you know, we can't just disregard all those interview requests, and I will do it if, you know, there is permission made. And so I kind of, you know, took an initiative, you know, to take all the interview requests. But it turned out that from the 13th of March during the 1 week period, I ended up with taking 50 interviews. And it included like very aggressive interviews by CNN, Cooper, or ABC's Christian Amato, and like all the people, you know, who want to interview Prime Minister Khan, and they request, you know, very strongly request the interview with Prime Minister. That I'm saying, well, Prime Minister's too busy. Like on the 15th or 14th, you know, it's a very hectic period, obviously. Sometime after, like around the 20th, Chief Cabinet Secretary Edano could spare more time for foreign media, and he was very proactive in taking interviews. And obviously, Mr. Edano is somebody who is a chief spokesperson. And I started to focus on arranging interviews for them. Mr. Edano eating strawberries in terms of CBS News, the strawberries from Fukushima and so forth. So there are some proactive media opportunities that I tried to create. Offered pieces by Prime Minister Khan. Actually, about 1 month later, Prime Minister Khan was contributing op-ed to the Washington Post and International Herald Tribune, which was actually eventually covered or carried by over 120 newspapers in the world. As Mark discussed, after 3/11, not only websites, but social media played such an important role. And myself and Kaji-san were discussing, you know, how we could strengthen our social media engagement and trying to see if we could introduce Facebook in addition to Twitter. And this was the kind of discussion we were having before 3/11. But after 3/11, there was no choice. I started to do my own Twitter feed, and it was so amazing. Like followers increased by 1,000 a day during a 1 week period post 3/11. Now we are trying to expand our cooperations into Chinese social media site and media outlet like the Sina Weibo. And as Mark explained, there are many things that we can do in terms of engaging the public or connecting, being connected with the rest of the world. And of course, you know, this was so important in light of outpouring of support from a global community under the situation of the post 3/11. What kind of issues we are tackling now, or we have been tackling? As you could imagine, post 3/11 situation in Japan posed so many challenging situations and issues facing the government and the private company like TEPCO. And our main focus was to strengthen communications through collaboration among different ministries and agencies. Immediately after 3/11, we were finding out that the messages sent out from different ministries did not really make sense altogether. And how we could have a more consolidated messages, consistent messages, was one very big issue. And the other issue was the issue of the crisis communications capacity and science communication capacity. And in the Japanese education or organizational system, I think there is a good room for us to improve our science communication. In many cases, communications are the jobs of the non-scientists in this country. And I think it has a very important lesson. We do need to do a better job in terms of science communications. And this is one issue that I have been discussing with Ambassador Warren about the role being played by Sir John Beddington, UK Chief Science Advisor. And as the ambassador would explain later, he was coming up with a very effective science communications from London, and he came to Japan. And there needs to be a kind of good combination of political messages and the messages coming from scientists in plain language. And that's the another lesson that I strongly feel about. And number three is we need to create a framework to align our activities of communications personnel and ministries. This is the kind of issue that we are tackling now. But in the Japanese government, each ministry has its own agenda. And when we put them together, as I mentioned, you know, they do not look very consistent. And how we could align them is the kind of area that we are tackling. And another issue is communications capacities and skills, and especially in English language. And here there is a strategic importance of Temple University. Temple University has been playing a very important role in Tokyo, especially by people like Robert or Kyle, who are organizing these kinds of events. And this is very important for our society. And in my opinion, you know, we should have more US and UK colleges in Tokyo and other places in Japan. Very lastly, the kind of themes that we are tackling now. It's about time for us to move forward with the proactive agenda. And in terms of like supply chain recovery, we have seen by the time of September of last year, about 80-90% of supply chains have been recovered. And Japanese economic growth is not bad, you know, in comparison to Eurozone or the United States. So our macroeconomic situations are not that bad, but now we have to focus on how we will realize open reconstruction. And as I mentioned at the outset, how we could realize the third opening of this country. And there are lots of issues that we can tackle as a matter of Japanese strength. We can focus on clean energy technologies, whether we could come up with effective models in Tohoku in terms of smart cities or future cities, or maybe especially in prefecture like Fukushima, focusing on renewable energy hubs, and more soft power related issues, Japan's attractions, cool Japan, tourism, sushi, you all know, you know these issues. And very lastly, Japanese values or philosophy. One example, very last comment of mine is that we are hosting the assistant meeting for Afghanistan last Sunday. And this is very important for us, just to demonstrate that Japan is committed to contributing to the global society, and especially in the area of human security. And this concept of human security is something that we attach much importance to, led by people like Madame Ogata. And especially after 3/11, you know, this is time for Japan and the Japanese people to be more proactive in the international society, to just repay all the favors and assistance extended to our society. So today I'm very happy to be surrounded, you know, by those people who have, probably many of you have made personal sacrifices and volunteer efforts, and I really appreciate your coming tonight. Thank you.
Our last panelist, Sir David Warren, is the British Ambassador to Japan. David Warren joined the Foreign and Commonwealth Office in 1975 and has spent much of his career dealing with Japanese and East Asian affairs in both Tokyo and London. Following 2 years full-time Japanese language study, he served in the British Embassy in Tokyo as private secretary to the ambassador and then second, later first secretary from 1978 to 1981, and as commercial counselor from 1993 to 1998, before returning to Tokyo as ambassador in July of 2008. His other posts in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office have included periods in the European Community Department dealing with international trade policy, serving as head of the political section of the British High Commission in Nairobi, Kenya, 2 years as deputy head of the FCO's Far East Department, a period on secondment to the Office of Science and Technology dealing with other issues, among other issues, with UK-Japan Science and Technology Corporation, and 2 years as head of the FCO's China-Hong Kong Department. In 2000, he became one of the senior management team for the Government Trade Promotion Organization, UK Trade and Investment, and he was created a Knight Commander of the Order of St. Michael and St. George in 2012. So let's welcome Sir David Warren.
A visual presentation, so maybe I can detach this and walk around and be a little bit more flexible. Thank you very much indeed for inviting me to take part in this seminar panel discussion this evening, and thank you to my co-panelists whose presentations I listened to with enormous interest. I'm really grateful to everybody for coming here tonight. I'm going to be as brief as I can be, because a lot of the themes that we want to talk about in the Q&A have, I think, already been raised, and I'm certainly not going to try and cover anything like the same sort of ground that, that Mark and Shikata-san have raised. Although, of course, our experience during and after the terrible crisis of March last year in some way resembles that of the US Embassy in terms of our immediate response and in terms of, although not on anything like the same scale as Operation Tamagotchi, of British organisations contributing in a small way to the initial rescue and recovery operation, and then later through the British Chamber of Commerce in Japan, through the Japan Society in the UK, and many other British friendship organisations for the task of recovery in the Tohoku region. What I want to focus on, if I may, in the next 5 or 10 minutes, are one or two themes that came out of the immediate response of the British Embassy to the earthquake and tsunami. When the earthquake struck that Friday afternoon, very much as the US Embassy had to, we immediately converted ourselves into a crisis center. The British Embassy is much smaller than the American Embassy, but we have in the whole of our diplomatic network in Japan about 130, 140 people here and in Osaka. And we were strengthened over that weekend with additional resilience from around the world, a number of people who were pre-positioned in what we call our rapid deployment teams, around 80 members of diplomatic staff who flew into Japan in order to enable us to cope with the enormous demands on our services over that first week or 10 days of the crisis. And in a sense, we had four crucial objectives and roles during that time. The first was to provide all the support, as well as the solidarity that we could, to the people and the government of Japan at a moment of national emergency. The first instruction I received from London in the immediate aftermath of the crisis was to find out what the Japanese government needed and to ensure that the British government could provide it or contribute to providing that assistance. Secondly, we have an immediate consular responsibility. We have had around 17,000 British nationals living in Japan, we believe. It is not compulsory for British nationals to register with the British Embassy, so we don't know how many thousands of people we have living in the country, but Japanese immigration statistics, which are very accurate, tell us that there were around 17,000. The vast majority were nowhere near the Tohoku region, but we had between 200 or 300 people in the prefectures immediately affected by the tsunami. And so our prime task was to find and assist British people who might have been caught up in these terrible events. Thirdly, and this is the particular issue on which I want to focus in more detail, we have the technical responsibility of providing travel advice to British nationals living in Japan and British people thinking of travelling to Japan. And that responsibility goes to the heart of what Shikata-san is talking about when we talk about communication. Because the travel advice that an embassy provides is the government's risk assessment of a crisis. And just as Mark said, everything that Ambassador John Roos said, every word he used, was pored over and analysed to indicate exactly how serious the crisis is, and what the prognosis of the crisis is going to be. So the travel advice that we issue goes to the heart of what we are saying to people about the seriousness of the risk. And of course, I have a fourth responsibility. I'm the British ambassador in Japan, but I'm also the manager and leader of a diplomatic team. I have a welfare responsibility to that team. I have a duty of care towards them. The 130 staff, the majority of those staff are Japanese nationals. Many of them had family and friends in the Tohoku region. Many of them began work in our crisis center involving travel to the Tohoku without knowing that their family and friends were safe. We have British diplomatic staff and their families to whom we also have a duty of care. So I have a welfare and management responsibility to discharge as well. Now, the risk assessment in this particular case was very complex, as everybody, I'm sure, who lived through those traumatic days will recall. This was not only a crisis of harrowing proportions in terms of the public images which were flashed around the world in the immediate aftermath of the tsunami, but a complex crisis as Fukushima Daiichi was immediately affected by the earthquake and the tsunami, and from the first explosion on the Saturday afternoon, Tokyo time. So assessing precisely what the element of risk was and what advice should be given to British nationals about their travel was something which not only required constant monitoring and assessment, and I mean constant because of course we are working around the clock in shifts, analysing and sifting information and making judgments as that information comes in, but also has to reflect shifting risk assessments at the Japanese end. Shikata-san was kind enough to mention the role of Sir John Beddington, the British government's chief scientific advisor. And John was crucial to this process. John Beddington is a distinguished scientist. He is the government's chief scientific advisor, which means he has an independent role reporting to the Prime Minister, but heading the government's Office of Science and Technology. He chairs a group called SAGE, the Scientific Advisory Group on Emergencies. This includes not only government scientists, who are civil servants working for government departments, but other scientists from independent organisations and independent scientists working in universities. So it is a mixture of civil servants, government scientists and independent scientists, and its advice is therefore, we think, definitive and impartial. It was John Beddington's responsibility during the crisis to provide advice to ministers on the risks that obtained from the developing events at Fukushima. And our initial travel advice, of course, was to advise people not to go to the Tohoku region. There was no way of getting to the Tohoku region other than if you were in an emergency service over the immediate aftermath of the tsunami. And advise against all non-essential travel to Tokyo and the region around Tokyo in view of the power outages, food shortages, and general sense of the impact on essential services that we saw in the immediate aftermath of the crisis. As Fukushima Daiichi developed, our advice had to develop. We advised against travel to the region. We advised against travel to the perimeter zone which the Japanese authorities imposed around the plant, as the US and other embassies recommended no travel within a wider perimeter zone. We followed suit. And at the moment where it was still not clear that the authorities were successfully bringing the crisis in Fukushima Daiichi under control to a degree that removed all sense of concern, we advised against non-essential travel to Tokyo, and also that those British residents in Tokyo might wish to consider relocating temporarily in view of the crisis which was unfolding. But we did not evacuate the embassy. The embassy remained at its post throughout the crisis, nor did we advise British nationals in Tokyo to leave the city. In other words, we did not recommend evacuation, although we offered evacuation to embassy families if they chose to take up the provision. Very few of them did. In other words, we were making an assessment which related directly to what John Beddington was saying, which was that in the reasonable worst case scenario, the risks from Fukushima Daiichi were manageable. They were manageable in the very unlikely event of the situation deteriorating in a way that brought radiation to Tokyo by individuals taking shelter and, if vulnerable, prophylactic medication, which we distributed to the British community in Tokyo and one or two other centres over the course of the weekend, which began Friday, Saturday, the 19th of March. Now, my point in emphasising this sequence of events is to focus on the way in which the scientific assessment was made and the way in which the government's risk assessment was then delivered on the back of that scientific analysis. There is, I know, a lot of interest in Japan about, and Shikata-san touched on this, about the idea of an independent government scientific advisor who can deliver such objective analysis at a time when there's understandable uncertainty and sometimes confusion about what is happening. Well, I think that the government's scientific advisor system works very well in the UK, but it's important to emphasize that although the scientific advisor is giving independent scientific advice, the decision on what advice to give people in terms of the risk and whether they should travel or not travel has to be taken by democratically accountable politicians. The Cabinet Office system in the UK, the Cabinet Committee structure, with the Prime Minister and its apex, responsible for making those judgments and then implementing those judgments and delivering them, is a politically accountable system. You can't take democratically elected politicians out of the mix in terms of how these decisions have to be made. Of course, there will be intense focus, as there was during that period, on how the advice is given and how the balance is maintained between ensuring that you are not putting, in this case, British citizens in harm's way, while at the same time not precipitating panic among the British community in ways which would be which would create massive difficulties for individuals. Now, that, in a sense, was at the heart of the judgments that were being made in the course of that week in terms of how to respond to the crisis. And I'd be very happy to take questions and talk about some of the issues which arose during that process. At the heart of it, as I say, was a judgment about risk. The judgment was that the risks in the worst case scenario that could be imagined and that could reasonably be expected to occur were manageable. And on the basis of that, it was important not only to keep diplomatic representatives in place, but to give balanced advice to individuals that would not precipitate panic. Now, John Bennington did four teleconferences with members of the British community in Tokyo during that period. They were an enormous value to individuals, and because it helped, I think, to calm and steady people's nerves at a very, very difficult time. It was also very important because the material which we disseminated on our website, British Embassy website, was retweeted, I think, very widely and helped, I believe, to perhaps inform a wider understanding of the issues which applied and the way in which risks were being evaluated. In the event, the travel advice, which had been tightened around the Thursday of the week immediately after the crisis, was relaxed towards the beginning of April by a similar process of evaluating risk and then considering in the context of the Cabinet Office's crisis structure whether it was appropriate to relax travel advice and send that message that it was now safer to return to Japan. Again, we're thinking of people's safety, but it's very important to remember, in the wake of the terrible events which everybody in this room lived through, how important it was to help Japan, the Japanese government, the Japanese people, to re-engage with the outside world, and how important it was to send an unequivocal message, in my case to people in the UK, that it was safe to travel to Japan, that it was important that people should travel to Japan, that the commercial, academic, cultural, human exchange partnerships, which an embassy exists to promote as actively as possible in Japan, should not be disrupted, but should be allowed to continue and indeed encouraged to continue. And quite a lot of the work I was doing in April, May last year was in order to encourage people to return to Japan and begin that process, while ensuring that they had a clear sense of the developments that were taking place at Fukushima. Walking this fine line between communicating a realistic sense of risk and respecting the views of people who have lived through a trauma and are understandably frightened and sometimes uncertain about what they're being told is a very, very difficult process. But I do think that it goes to the heart of the effective communication which Shikata-san is talking about. And I have to say, if I can add just a personal note from British ambassador's perspective, that communication is at the heart of an embassy's response to the crisis. I spent the Friday afternoon of the crisis, the 11th of March, desperately trying to get back into Tokyo from Yokohama. I was in Yokohama when the earthquake took place. It took me 6 hours to get back into the center of the city because of gridlock. I had to walk the last mile or two to get back to the embassy and take my place at the crisis center. I spent the Saturday on the phone to London and to media trying to communicate a sense of where we should be going and what we should be doing and the advice we should be giving to people. I went to Sendai on the Sunday morning to lead the first consular team into the earthquake zone to find and assist some of the 200 to 300 British nationals who we knew to be living in that area. I spent 3 days in Sendai and the towns which had been devastated by the tsunami, Minamisan, Kesen, Tadajo, and the suburbs of Sendai, helping to locate a few dozen of the British nationals, teachers, professors, artists, long-term residents of the region, because they're all long-term residents of the Tohoku, offering them assistance with evacuation if they wanted it. Some did. We brought them down to Tokyo, to Kyoto, over the next few days, and then expected them to return. They returned to their homes. Providing that essential service to British nationals, and also, insofar as we could, and we all felt desperately incapable as we confronted the unthinkable devastation that we all witnessed, that we could try and find some way of beginning the process of helping the people of Japan to recover from this awful calamity. I want just to finish on that point, because I've talked in some detail about exactly what we did in terms of our responsibility to British nationals. The abiding memory that all of us have from that week and the succeeding days was the impact that these events had on people in the UK who were profoundly moved and humbled by the extraordinary courage of the Japanese people that they saw. And those of us who were in the area affected felt that very deeply, very intensely. I'll leave it at that point, if I may, Kyle, and look forward to Q&A. But thank you very much for your attention.
If you could please identify yourself and ask your questions and wait for a microphone.
First question is in the very back. This will actually reach you soon while getting those other mics up.
David Hume from Europe is Japan. A couple of, well, you all touched on the social media aspect of this, which has also been addressed. Just a couple of days ago, the Google tent in Sendai, which appears to have been a very vigorous exchange of views with some 400 people attending, I wonder, Mr. Davis, whether there was anybody from your office at that meeting?
We also had the Secretary of State who was on her way to Tokyo, so we were unable to send anyone from here. But in the way that we divvy up Japan in terms of our diplomatic presence here, we have a consulate general in Sapporo that is responsible for Hokkaido and the four northernmost prefectures of Tohoku, including Miyagi, Ken, Sendai. So we did have one of my colleagues from the consulate general who was there as well, too.
And if I may, Mr. Shikata, I wonder whether you could tell us something about what happens going forward with social media and with the way that the government disseminates information. The attitude in the past, some of us have been here a long time, regard the attitude as kind of from ministry to ministry, varying degrees of defensiveness in terms of, you know, letting anything out. Everything is kind of a secret until there's a really good reason for it not to be. So how do you improve that situation? Do you get the ministries to tweet each other and then go from there? Or how is it likely to resolve this cultural problem that Japan has about, well, the Japanese government or bureaucracy has about communication? Thank you.
Well, actually, I was briefing international press from around the 20th of March up until the end of April, every day, once a day, daily international press briefings. And so I was with the Nuclear Industrial Safety Agency, Nuclear Safety Commission, and with the Food Safety Concerns, Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Health and Welfare, among others, and Foreign Office. So this is those were the occasions, you know, that we tried to provide opportunities for international media to be able to ask various questions. But as related to science communications, not many officials, you know, who are briefing the press were trained in a kind of professional base. So especially at the beginning, you know, we were struggling with handling the questions and also I guess, you know, there, in many cases, you know, there was not much intention to hide the information, but how we could put those figures into context was so such a challenge. And all of a sudden, you know, we were starting to talk about microsieverts and Becquerel and whether they are safe or not. And in many cases, you know, I was feeling that, you know, we could have done a better job in terms of communicating, you know, those issues. And of course, you know, under those situations, we were trying to struggle, you know, with English language, and not many people are trained, you know, to do that. But the case that I'm making nowadays is, as long as we have nuclear power plants in this country, we need to have professionals who will be able to engage in those situations, whatever happens. So so I'm kind of, you know, advocate of being more or better equipped with handling this kind of crisis communication situations.
Aaron Chaudhry, Thomson Reuters, Tokyo. You all talk about communicating during the times of crisis, and I wonder if you could all give your comment on Kurokawa Sensei's independent panel investigation that was released its judgment last week, findings. They were very, very straightforward. I read the English language version, there's some very harsh language in the executive summary. And just as a corollary to that, I wonder, has Japan's government in a way missed an opportunity by starting up the OE reactors before setting up a properly independent nuclear regulator and before the full facts of the disaster have been established? We've seen, as I think one of the presentations said, foreign visitor numbers down 50%, and I think residents, long-term residents, are down quite considerably as well. And many people, and these are people that Japan really needs to continue cultural, commercial exchanges, etc. Sorry for my question so long. If you could all comment on that, please.
That's a big question. There are lots of different issues there. I should be pretty brief. Some of that really is for the Japanese government, I think, to respond to in terms of its energy strategy. At the moment, the government is developing an energy strategy, which will be published, I think it now looks like being published towards the end of August. And that strategy will determine what, if any, proportion of Japan's future energy requirements are found from nuclear. The government's decision to start up the Ohi reactors, I assume, but it's pretty straightforward, reflects the need to have access to stable energy supplies in the regions covered by Ohi in the Kansai over the summer months. We will wait to see what the government determines its nuclear requirements are. And I can't and shouldn't preempt the decision which is taken by the government's committees. From the British perspective, I should say, I come from a country which is committed to nuclear energy as part of the future energy mix. And it is committed to nuclear energy because it sees no way of meeting the carbon emissions reduction targets and moving to the sort of low carbon society which we want to create in the United Kingdom and in the European Union without the provision of some nuclear energy as part of that. So for us, nuclear energy is central to our future energy requirements, but every country is making different judgments on that question. I'm going not to respond directly to your request for a direct comment on Professor Kurokawa's report. I have read the report. It makes trenchant, and I imagine difficult reading, in terms of its strong criticism of many aspects of the management of the crisis. It must be a sign of a very healthy political debate in Japan that these criticisms have been aired so publicly and so forcefully. I have to say, as Mark said in his presentation, that those of us who lived through the crisis in those days and weeks, felt that everything that was being done that could be done to try and get hold of a situation which was unthinkable and which no one had previously experienced. And incidentally, I should say in that context, because I'm an old Japan hand, that I was in Japan at the time of the Kobe earthquake in 1995 and recall strongly the difficulty that many experienced at that time in terms of determining exactly how quickly emergency services should be deployed to an earthquake zone, which we did not see in the events of March the 11th last year.
As you know, there are multiple reports, of course, revealed Japan, Shikata, and Shikata, Nabashi, and Dr. Kurokawa's report, and the Japanese government's own investigation commission has not yet come up with a final report. So there are various reports from different angles, and as the reports are being published, you know, there are a number of points, you know, that we have to, you know, reflect upon. And the last week's report of Dr. Kurokawa, there are issues, very important issues, you know, that were raised in terms of the need for us, you know, to be prepared before the accident happens, and also the need for the government to have an effective crisis communication, you know, mechanism, you know, set in place, and also learning for Japan to learn from other countries' experiences. So there are numerous issues that we need to embrace ourselves. And at the end of the day, you know, this is not an accident isolated in this country. We need to share the lessons. And I guess, you know, we need to keep on trying how we could improve our system. And as related to Ambassador, you know, Warren's point for comments on energy policy, we are coming up with a new kind of methodology, so the deliberative polling. And so there's a new approaches being introduced in the formation of our new energy policy. And this is, again, some of the new attempts that we are engaging. And another point is governance of the nuclear power industry. There is a criticism that why are we reforming our system before the final report of the government itself is not yet published? But of course, there are some urgent issues, you know, that the government needs to tackle, and of course, you know, this point is being debated in relations with the restarting of OE nuclear power plants. But we are, at least as a government, accepting some of the shortcomings of the past system. And we are moving on to the new system, which is under the jurisdiction of Minister of Environment. And as a result of parliamentary discussion, we decided to come up with a highly independent commission. I'm not saying that all the lessons to be learned is something we have already learned, but we need to keep on learning. But as a practical or pragmatic policy issues, you know, we need to tackle as issues exist as of today.
But very briefly, as I indicated during my presentation, the complex sequence of events and challenges faced by Japan on 3/11 and immediately thereafter were unprecedented for the industry. And I think it would defy any of us to imagine any perfect response to that combination of disasters. A tremendous amount went right. A tremendous amount went right. First, perhaps foremost, the response of the Japanese people. The stoicism, the decorum, kinkaku, almost, not only was something that amazed the world, but is something that permitted the orderly delivery of supplies as quickly and efficiently as possible under those terrible circumstances. The ways in which Japan, after the inevitable difficulties of the early days, managed to mesh up with friends from the United Kingdom, the United States, or other countries around the world, to try to help people who were in need and move forward. They're truly remarkable accomplishments. So it is the sign of an extraordinarily healthy democracy that these series of reports focuses on what went wrong, how can we do better the next time. And I think back, for instance, to the commission that was set up, the Kimini Commission, after Three Mile Island in the United States. Extraordinarily critical of our nuclear industry, of the regulatory regime under which our nuclear power plants operated, and suggested ways to do better, hopefully, not next time, but to do better in the future to prevent something from happening like that. Similarly, after 9/11, no one was more critical of the errors the mistakes, the fallacies that permitted 9/11 to occur, then the American people, American media, and the commission that was set up to investigate that and to suggest ways in which we must prevent something like that from happening again. So I take this criticism as the sign of a tremendous maturity of Japan's politics and a real sign of optimism for the future. And I think just as a final note, it's very interesting to see the impact it's having on politics in Japan at the moment. I, of course, will not comment on Japanese internal politics, other than to note that it's very interesting for an observer, an affectionate observer such as myself of Japan, to see and to trace and to speculate on the future of, I would say, an emerging division between kind of old-style politics of personality, of faction, of loyalty, and a politics of policy. A politics of, say, you know, we need to take a hard calculation about where we are today, what's happening in our society, and maybe we better think about paying a higher consumption tax to allow us to go forward. But the point I'd like to make is that there is a policy debate in Japan. It's up to the Japanese people to decide who they wish to choose as their leaders and how Japan will proceed forward. But it's very, very interesting to see how any democracy shows its strength not in times of peace and ease, but in times of crisis. And I would say that Japan's democracy, like I believe America's democracy and UK's democracy after 7/11, for instance, have tried to learn the lessons, integrate them into policies, and do better into the future.
Sorry, can I just respond? And let me hasten to say, I'm coming here to write a story. I'm taking notes, so I'm not necessarily quoting you. I think the point I was trying to make is there is a lack of faith in what the government's So I'm just wondering how you can capture that faith, especially given people have left and people have come. Thank you.
So very briefly.
We have other people who have questions.
Yeah. The transparency and accountability, and we need to work on that, on those issues even harder.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Sorry,
don't
mind.
Can I go?
I'll have you go next.
Okay, thank you. Gail Sato, I teach American literature at Meiji University. I'm an American citizen. I have a question mainly for Mr. Shikata, and it's about the science communications. I think this is really key. Last week in this room, we had Professor Bugo Hayano. His English is amazing. He's involved with CERN in Switzerland. So using him as an example, it seems to me that there are many people in Japan, scientists, with fantastic English skills and the knowledge to talk to the lay public about what is a millisievert and how to convert it to a becquerel and that kind of thing. And I'm wondering why there has been no visible effort to me in the government. There ought to be some agency, even one individual, who is coordinating the organization of scientists in Japan. How hard could it be in the age of the internet? And so there's several specific issues that I just want to put on the table. Is there an analogy to SAGE being developed here, or does it exist? Why was the US real-time radiation information not used? It went by email. Are we doing baseline radiation measurements for future epidemiological studies? Why is the government so apparently unwilling to do all-out radiation measurements? There were billions of dollars in donations. Professor Hayano said, we don't have enough machines to measure people in Tohoku. I find it kind of mind-boggling in Japan with its cutting-edge technology and all this money. So I think also part of the scientific communication responsibility is, where did all the money go? You know, how was all the donation money spent? How much of it went to radiation-related? Sorry, you may not be the person. This is the Amanpour aggressive interview, perhaps. But and thank you for doing all those interviews. But you know, I think these are the concrete questions that science communication from the government has to deal with. So what do you think of that?
Thank you. Over Twitter, I have been in close touch with the Professor Hayano. And as you point out, I thought at the very early stages of post-311 days that he could be a very effective speaker, and especially for the international audience. But he had many other things to do. And my case is that we need more professors like Dr. Hayano in this country. And I'm thinking we have enough. And if, you know, among your audience, if you recommend some people, you know, who could come on board, you know, with the CNN or BBC interviews, I very much like to, you know, hear from you. You know, please send it, you know, messages through Twitter or whatever, you know, Facebook or whatever. And I have been looking for those people. But my case is that our education system needs to change to have, you know, more people like that. And we are kind of, you know, not making best use of our talents. I'm talking especially at the stage of like, you know, high school or entrance exam, you know, to colleges. And it's not the matter of scientific knowledge or expertise, but the combination of English communication ability and the scientific knowledge, when you match, you know, those two factors, it gets really difficult, in my opinion.
Hi. That may be well down, but well, first of all, I want to thank all of you for being here tonight. I mean, Skypos, I'm a very citizen, but it's great to see this particular team on the field. You know, the UK, the US, and Japan have worked well together in other parts of the world, and hopefully it will continue to do so. Unfortunately, the gentleman from Reuters stole my question. So rather than beat that into the ground, I might piggyback on, I had the microphone, I will just piggyback on something with a story that took place not far from here. I was having a pizza with my daughter at a local restaurant, and was met an Italian gentleman there that I've known for a long time. He happens to do a lot of research in nuclear areas. It's a great pizza. I said, oh yeah, my friend just opened the restaurant. He said, oh, well, can you please tell them not to use wood from Fukushima? Now, this is a rather terrifying thing to hear when you're sitting in Azawajima and having a pizza, that, you know, maybe you have to be concerned if, you know, the wood that's cooking the pizza comes from Fukushima. And, you know, I think that's the level of kind of concern when as a foreigner, when you kind of hear that, you know. Fusoli knows, because he's, you know, they're checking. You know, it does leave us some concern, and I very much hope that, you know, through this, the Kurosawa report and otherwise, that we're moving to a new era of openness in Japanese politics, perhaps. But I'm sorry to have to put this on the Japanese representative, but do you have any thoughts related to that?
Not specifically about pizza.
This underlying fear and concern that maybe, you know, we don't know something.
I guess you know, this issue of so-called reputational damages still is being today, and there are even today, nearly 40 countries, you know, that have just introduced import restrictions that Japanese, you know, food exports. And we have been having a very difficult time in just realizing the abolition of, you know, those restrictions. And so this is not limited to international reputation damage. You know, they do exist in this country when we try to dispose debris, not from Fukushima, but from Iwate or even Miyagi. And then when we try to bring, you know, those debris to other prefectures, you know, there are some oppositions. At the same time, it's not all the oppositions. You know, there are many cities and prefectures, you know, that sent, they take initiative to dispose them. I think what we need to remind ourselves is the importance of sticking to the science and a scientific approach. And I heard that last week at the TUZ, there was a discussion on this issue as related to Anshin and Anzen. Yeah. And Anzen is science, but Anshin is more, you know, subjective, right? And in a Japanese society, we have to remind ourselves that you know, we have been, on many occasions, emphasizing Anshin maybe too much. And we may be, you know, suffering, you know, some of the consequences. And so we need to be careful and also try to, especially on issues like, you know, food safety, we need to stick to international standard. If there is no standard, we need scientists, you know, need to collaborate.
Can I just add a point on this? I want to make two points, really. One is about food safety, and one is a more general point, picking up what Shikata-san said. I know you're not asking about food safety, but can I just make a point here that the British government's advice, it's on our website, so if you want to look at this in more detail, is quite clear that as far as the UK government is concerned, the controls that the Japanese government have put in place are more than adequate to prevent contaminated food entering the food chain. Now, that is the assessment of the Food Standards Agency in the UK, and it reflects not only their understanding of the exhaustive testing which the Japanese authorities have carried out, but also the fact that the standards in Japan tend to be higher and more demanding on food safety than in many other countries. I'm not qualified to speak on behalf of the Italian embassy, but my Italian colleague told me that in Italy, where responsibility for food safety is, I think, devolved to individual regions, there has been exhaustive analysis of Japanese government practices, and they too are confident that they prevent contaminated food entering the food chain. Okay. I make that point not to close off discussion of that subject, but simply so that you know exactly what our advice is to British nationals. I'm sure that the US embassy has something in parallel. The other point that Shikata-san was making is about de-risking all these judgments, in a sense, anshin or anzen. And my point at the beginning was, if I can just repeat it, that this is not something which you can divorce ultimately from political accountability. The judgments which we made and continue to make on food safety, and if you look at our website, you will find a very detailed analysis of the blogosphere rumours which are out there about Unit 4 at Fukushima Daiichi, because I know that there is a lot of talk on the internet about the dangers of Unit 4. You'll find an analysis on, in our travel advice, is advice which, you know, we are accountable for. We monitor it, we keep it up to date, we are confident in it, but ultimately, although it is based on the most objective and considered scientific advice available to us, ultimately, it is the government's responsibility to make those judgments. And these are ours.
We have a diplomat and former foreign minister spokesman in the tech policy. I very much agree with my former colleague Shikata-san's point about the need to foster global communication mindset and as well as skills. As far as the mindset is concerned, I feel that what we in the Japanese government need is
one of the things we need is the ability to frame clear, simple messages at the beginning of a crisis. In that context, I was very much interested in hearing Mark Richardson talk about the strategic message on Ambassador Roos's part, such as, don't panic, the best minds of the world are working on this. Japan is open for business. I think you had one or two other points. I think the important point is that those were 4 or 5 points. How did you manage to frame that? What was the process in which you, I mean, you must have done that in a very short frame, short time frame. How did you go about doing that?
Full disclosure, I was not actually in Japan at the time. but since coming here in March of this year, I've worked very closely with the ambassador in the range of his communications activities. There's no particular magic at work here. It is perhaps just a habit of mind. This is the way in which one communicates in the modern world. One needs to be strategic. One needs to be strategic, to look at what is the goal that we're trying to achieve here. Communications, words, are as much of an act in this day and age as anything that we can actually do. And words have impact, particularly at a time, as we've all discussed, in which every single word, in fact, is being parsed the ultimate degree for what shade of meaning we're actually trying to convey. So the basic rule of thumb for American candidates when they're running for political office is KISS. Keep it simple, stupid. Keep it simple and short. If you recall when Bill Clinton ran for the presidency for the first time successfully, I mean, his campaign, James Carville's famous dictum, it's all about the economy, stupid, right? Focus like a laser beam on a single issue. So it's a habit of mind. It's a habit of mind of just thinking one step ahead. What are we trying to achieve by this? We need to be truthful and transparent, but we need to be simple.
And I think you need to be very clear about what you do not know.
I'm Hiroshi Meguro from Hosei University Institute of Okinawa Studies, and thank you very much for your very informative presentation. My question is related to information. And in the case of disasters, particularly this is the case with the nuclear power plants, as it is, how much information should be disclosed to the public right away? Sometimes conflicting messages are an issue, and don't panic, and stay calm, kind of thing, and move quickly or act quickly. And sometimes the citizens need to choose, which way to go. But in the case of Fukushima nuclear power plant accidents, probably too late to build, particularly at the beginning. And it's related to Japanese culture, or political culture, or political climate, and so on and so forth, or so-called nuclear village. But do you think it's changing, or still it's there? And this question is to Mr. Shikata. But I could ask you to other panelists about your own country. What kind of principles there?
I guess, for example, as related to the situation of the nuclear power plant accidents, there could be three categories of information. One is that we know what's happening. The government knows what's happening, and we release that information, number one. Number two is we know the info, but we don't disclose it, we don't announce it. Number three is we don't know what's happening, and especially like exact situation of the inside of the container vessel. Probably we did not know all the inputs. But the third category is very tricky, you know, because the public expects that the government or TEPCO, you know, should know all the information. So there is a difficult issue of, as Ambassador Warren said, you know, we should not say what we don't know. You know, that's very important. But at the same time, I'm not making the case that we should keep all the information confidential. Of course, you know, we need to be attentive, you know, to information disclosure. And there has been lots of debate about speedy. And my understanding is that the government will change how we will handle, you know, this information of speedy. We do not do it, you know, again, as we have done, you know, under the situations of post 311. But at the same time, how we would manage the situation when we do not know, we should probably try to make extra efforts to explain the reason why we don't know, you know, certain information.
Here, I have a mic, so just let me comment. Let me make just comment and questions. A lot of things are just related about the incapability of English-speaking scientists or politicians. But we cannot afford spending time to train ourselves to be able to speak English. Instead, my suggestion is to find the good leaders amongst the society that the people are hassling about. In other words, the business society is the place where there can be a lot of good leaders. And those leaders can be a member of the parliament and the cabinet. And that is the situation I am anticipating as a private citizen of Japan. Hashimoto and Ishihara and Ozawa, terrible, sounds terrible to many of you, but maybe the one who can open up the new world. Problem is, they don't speak English. Therefore, they are going to employ good English-speaking young guys to train the Japanese to the future. What do you think?
Yes, sir.
I think we're preaching to the audience with Shikata. We wouldn't have the problem if there were more people like him in the government.
The reason why I have been emphasizing English communications capabilities, it doesn't have to be all the Japanese leaders, or, you know, we need to have certain number of people, you know, who can handle the situation. And my case is that the number is too small, you know, the just sample is too small, and our system is not producing those people. And this relates to English, you know, the English education, and how organizations are training, you know, their employees in a kind of strategic manner. And this becomes very acute under the, say, breaking news of CNN or BBC. And as Mark was, you know, saying, that you need to behave not like Japanese under those situations, right? The game is so different. So we need under those situations, we need to have, you know, some people who can handle it. And I think, you know, all most of you, you know, would probably have some sympathy on the points that I'm trying to make. So of course, you know, whatever the leadership, you know, we have in the future in this country, you know, that there could be, you know, some new appointment from the business circles or, you know, media background, or, you know, we need to have, in my vocabulary, maybe all Japan efforts on this issue.
If I could very, very briefly, Shikata-san, I'm surprised you're appealing to that old guy accent thing again. This is what Davidson's going to say. I'm a career foreign service officer of the government. I spent 25 years working in the government, so I'm kind of an inside guy. And of course, a lot of us who work for the U.S. government tend to, by nature, decry the political appointment system that we have, whether it be as ambassadors or as, you know, the leaders of our cabinet agencies in the United States. In most instances, however, I think it's extraordinarily healthy. I have worked in recent years for a number of extraordinary political appointees who have been very successful in various fields of endeavor and are brought into the government for what everyone understands is a short period of time and can focus all of their energy, their creativity, and skills from the outside on what needs to be changed and what needs to be moved forward in the bureaucracy. Because bureaucrats in any culture in the world tend to be somewhat inflexible. For instance, in Washington, I worked 2 years for the former chief operating officer of Discovery Communications. It was an extraordinary learning experience for me to be infused with a kind of private sector strategic-based approach to global communications. And as with Ambassador Bruce, who comes from Silicon Valley, is an extraordinary attorney, very focused on entrepreneurship. He's been the president of the creation of many of the great startups in Silicon Valley, and here he's bringing that focus on entrepreneurship and innovation to our public engagement opportunities in Japan as well, too. But the point I'd like to make is that in recent years, of course, Japan has started to bring people from the outside into the government as well. I think a tremendous example now is Minister Morimoto of the Defense Minister, who has, I may say, been a tremendous public advocate just in recent days in favor of the U.S.-Japan security relationship. And I think this is good in any bureaucracy to have people from a variety of different areas coming in and bringing in a short-term, highly focused, very driven focus on changing things for the better. And I've seen that start in the Japanese system as well, too. I think that that's a good sign.
We have time for one more question.
Thank you very much. My name is Kuniko Suzuki from the Okazaki Institute, and I also I used to work work at the University of Tokyo, managing the project called Security and Safety. It was an ANSI project, so working together with government people and also company people and also scientists. So and today, I thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, and Mr. Davidson, and Shikata-san. We learned lots today's presentations, very different presentation, and I can say that as a crisis management, I think the example of the British example is a perfect crisis management. I can say that because the chief, what is the priority 4 points? Ambassador Guri explained us. It's a and good. How can I say? As a Japanese student, I didn't really trust the government information, I have to say, honestly. So sometimes I checked really the British embassy's website. I really trust British British information because after the terrorist 1986, I listened to all the information from Italy, France, and also from Britain, and British information is really correct. And very, really think of that. How to protect the national, British nationals. So I would really much trust the information I understand. And it's a really perfect, great example of crisis management. And thinking of the US government example, I think it's more than crisis management. It's really goodwill. I really thank the Tomonet operation. And now it's not finished. It's Tomonet initiatives. Your ambassador also explained the Tomonet Initiative at the Independence Day of the United States. I really appreciate and really that. And also last year, just after the, not last maybe, anyway, last year, I also listened to how much you want for us to, after the March 11th? Because most, I have to say that other countries, many people went out from Japan, but from the United States, more people coming into Japan to assist us, to help us. So I'm really proud and I'm really happy to have a good ally and friends as the United States. I really thank you for that. And to at Japan, I have to say, Japan, it's not a crisis management, but it's now the government facing management crisis. So I would say people of Japan, especially people in Tokyo, they are very impatient and in a good manner. So I as a prime have good people in Tohoku that we can have a good reputation from the abroad. But unfortunately, the leadership and the central government, it is not really effective. I have to say that. And also that the presentation, in the United States and in the Britain, they have a risk assessment first. But in Japan, we don't have risk, but we have more.
Thank you so much.
Okay. I'm sorry for that. I have to say before.
No, it's okay. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for your very kind remarks about No, seriously, I'm very grateful. Thank you and many other things that they found on our website useful. Can I just make a point here, which is that Martin Mayfield applies to the US as well, but I can't assume that. I explained what we did and I explained what we felt our responsibilities were. I didn't get into all the detail about how we structured ourselves, but you gather that we have a proper crisis structure in such situations. We are doing this against a background in the UK and in many other countries of public and press opinion, which is rightly very demanding of its public servants that they deliver the highest quality of public services, and would not be tolerant simply to be told, well, it's a crisis, therefore it's difficult for us. People understand at times of crisis when situations are uncertain, and it's going to be more difficult. But nonetheless, the press, public organizations, civil society in the UK, holds its politicians, its civil servants, its diplomats abroad, to very high standards of delivery. So this is a system which we have tried to evolve to deal with crises against the knowledge that if we fall short, we will be ruthlessly criticized and held up to very, very tough scrutiny, not only in the press, by the public, but also by Parliament, who scrutinize everything we do. So I emphasize that so that you would not think that this is coming out of a perfect system which just delivers this automatically. It's delivered against the background of having made mistakes in the past and having learned from those mistakes and trying all the time, Kaizen, I should say, try and get better. And I was conscious all the time throughout the weeks of the crisis that, of course, we did not do everything correctly. We did make mistakes. Of course we made mistakes. We became tired. People were frightened. People were exhausted. And they make more mistakes when that happens. And one of my jobs as a leader was to say to people, get rest, eat properly, go get some sleep, because you are going to be making more mistakes than the normal. Criticism that will arise from that will demoralize you. That should not be there. So let's just, I want to end in a sense on emphasizing the difficulty of getting this right and how we have to continually try to improve the performance which we, you know, which we deliver. That's what we feel we should do.
Let me very briefly thank you for your very generous comments about the United States. But just as the outpouring of feeling and of assistance for Japan was truly global, I know that your appreciation is also global. Without getting too philosophical at the end of a long and interesting session, it is truly in moments of extremity and crisis that I think we realize what's what's most elemental in all of our lives, which are these human bonds that bring us together. If the United States was able to be physically present faster and in greater numbers than other countries, it's because we were, the bystander when our neighbor's house caught on fire that happened to have the bucket. And so we pitched right in. We had the capability and the means because of the forward deployment of our military forces in Japan. And it was only natural that we would use what was at hand, the means to do everything we could to help. But certainly the goodwill toward Japan and the desire to help. I was in Pakistan and everyone I met was very concerned, just as much as I was, about what was happening here and wanted to find a way to help, even though they didn't have the economic or obviously military means to do so. One of the truly great things about this country is this sense of gratitude, this humility, a trait that's been present in Japanese culture since forever. But even the bumper stickers on the taxis you see here, and the banners, you know, in central Tokyo expressing thanks to the world, it's just another admirable trait of the people of Japan that we've seen emerge. So again, if we are to conclude this evening looking for a silver lining in the terrible tragedy that all of us witnessed and many of us experienced personally a year and a half ago, it is these human bonds that were created.
Today I'm very lucky, you know, to be sitting next to, you know, my friends, and of course, you know, this is the kind of a reminder, as far as I'm concerned, to me about, you know, friends in need, friends indeed, and there are so many occasions, you know, that throughout you know, post the 3/11 period. I was kind of assisted, helped, you know, by my colleagues from my U.S. Embassy or U.K. Embassy, and both governments. And this is something that we need to remind ourselves of, the importance of international partnership, you know, under those difficulties. You know, this is number one point. And the second point is I was trying to convey to you, you know, some of the activities, and I know that, you know, our capability was not enough, you know, because on the day of 3/11, we had six, you know, people in our office, and we were confronted, you know, by these, you know, enormous, you know, challenges, and so now we have a bit over 10 people in my office, but still, these kind of activities are not kind of well appreciated in the Japanese society, and it's a bit similar to the role of TUJ. You know, not many people understand the strategic importance of this university. So, and, you know, just, you know, last word, you know, so I'm so fortunate, you know, to be able to attend today's panel, and this is the best panel that I attended, you know, in my current life. Thank you very much.